Doctor Who, The Ark, by Paul Erickson. Read by Peter Purves. Chapter 1, The Steel Sky. Jungle. Lush foliage crowded in upon itself beneath the tall trees. Here and there, amid dark shadows cast by overhanging branches, small pools of light picked out brightly coloured flora. Shimmering mist hovered in patches over the dense tangles of undergrowth, thinning away in places to reveal small clearings. Into the still air rose a murmur of activity from the teeming jungle floor, pierced by sharp cries which indicated the presence of larger forms of life. Animals. A minor bird fluttered from branch to branch, its eyes picking out the familiar scene. Other birds, some in flight, others resting. And on the ground, a lion padding from one copse to another, causing gazelles to scatter from its path in a flurry of alarm. A cacophony of chatter, and monkeys which had been picking at the kernels of fallen nuts scampered up trees to reach safety. The lion having passed, the other animals re-emerged to feed upon the shrubbery. Zebras, kangaroos, tortoises, and many other species mingled together in the ebb and flow of a densely packed animal kingdom. Among them, reptiles. So that a particular form of reptile life that moved among them passed unnoticed, obviously representing no threat. But this creature was different from the snakes and lizards that were normally found in this jungle. In the first place, it walked upright on two legs, two arms hanging at its sides. It made no sound, not even the hissing that other reptiles might make. And while its body was covered in scales, the head boasted a mop-like thatch of ginger hair. Facially, it displayed three shrunken nostrils and a small, thin mouth, from which a tongue occasionally flicked out. But its most prominent feature was a large single eye that constantly swiveled as it looked around. An eye that apparently accepted the scene as being normal. Having found it so, the creature moved on, disappearing into the shadows of the undergrowth. No sooner had the creature disappeared than a different, alien sound was heard in the jungle. A whirring, mechanical noise that disturbed the sweltering, humid place. And as it echoed and then died away, the TARDIS police box materialised in the glade. At first, there was a startled and uncertain reaction from the crowded animals. Then, as silence returned, they resumed their business of foraging for food. The door of the TARDIS opened, and Dodo Chaplet emerged. An elfin-like teenager, she was dressed in the fashion of a page from the period of the Crusades. She gazed around at the jungle that surrounded her and, in wonder, moved forward to touch the bark of a tree as though to make sure that it was real. Finding that it was, she became conscious of the steamy, clinging heat of the place. And in response to it, she suddenly found her nose itching. Her fingers pinched at her nose, attempting to stifle a sneeze. But it came bursting forth.
A tissue!
Dodo brushed her fingers across her nose and shook her head, seeking to clear it. Then she glanced up as Stephen came out from the time machine to join her. He looked at her with barely concealed annoyance.
And just where do you think you're going?
Out. I thought I'd get some fresh air,
Dodo replied defiantly.
Nobody said you could go out, Stephen snapped.
Do they have to then?
Of course they do.
Stephen shook his head in bewilderment at her recklessness.
You don't know what you might have found out here. No gravity, poisoned atmosphere, all sorts of things.
Dodo started to move away from him.
Look, stop tramping around over there. What happens if you get lost?
In that case, I catch a bus back, came the answer.
A bus?
Again, Stephen shook his head. What do you think you're talking about? I mean, just where do you think you are?
Ah, I bet you think you've caught me, don't you? I'll bet you think I don't know.
You do? Stephen asked.
Of course I do,
Dodo replied with confidence.
What? This place with all these strange animals and plants and things? You can't have been here before.
Yes, I have. I came here once with my school. It's called Whipsnade. It's just outside London.
Just outside? Now, wait a minute. Dodo pointed away from the glade through the trees.
I'll bet if you go down that path there, you'll come to the American bison and the tea bar.
Stephen sighed in exasperation. We don't even know that we're on Earth, he argued.
Earth? Earth?
Dodo countered scornfully.
This place couldn't be anywhere else now, could it?
She indicated.
That's a chameleon. And over there, those are Malayan gazelles.
She peered at a bush.
And on these leaves, locusts.
How do you know all this? Stephen asked.
Learned it at school. Natural history.
From the depths of the woods, a baying howl echoed. Dodo jumped, losing something of her confidence. Stephen grinned. Having second thoughts?
No, I just don't remember Whipsnade being so loud, that's all.
Inside the TARDIS, the Doctor pored over the instruments with a puzzled expression. He shook the space longitude indicator, not quite believing its reading, but the figures that it spelled out remained steady. And it was the same with all the other instruments. However much he tapped and tweaked at them, the initial readings remained obstinately the same.
Strange, he muttered. Very strange.
What was strange about them was the fact that they were all apparently working, and all at the same time. And this really perplexed the Doctor, because it was indeed a rare day when something wasn't going wrong in his old warhorse TARDIS. He could hardly remember the last time they'd combined to give such consistent readings. He scratched his chin.
Now, not since that trip to Venezia, or was it Enlandia? That strange place where the one thing they didn't have was land, nothing but water, and that peculiar form of crystal ice.
He quivered, momentarily remembering the place well. It still gave him the shivers to think of it and remember the giant eels that had squirmed their way about the place. But no, the readings were what they were. And he glanced up when he heard the youngsters outside talking about the possibility of finding themselves on Earth. The Doctor emerged from the TARDIS, shaking his head in bewilderment. He glanced at Dodo and Stephen.
Improbable as it may seem, the child Dorothea, Dodo,
the teenager protested.
Oh yes, of course, the Doctor conceded. I think Dodo may be right.
Stephen was puzzled.
You mean it is Earth? He asked.
The Doctor shook his head cautiously.
I can't tell you just yet, not for certain. All I can say is that it is more likely to be Earth than anywhere else, but it's very strange all the same.
He grasped the lapels of his jacket.
You know, I've been taking a look at my instruments in there. My readings are, well, very strange.
Then he shrugged his shoulders as though finding a delight in a problem.
Yes, very strange indeed.
Elsewhere, activity was taking place in a control room. A central panel was the obvious focus of all this activity. Monitor screens gave a constant display of everything that was going on, both within the control room and outside it. Fingers moved levers, and the effect on the combined screens gave those within the control room a constant update on the information they required. Those fingers belonged to humans.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.